welcome to Conversations on Social Issues. So for those who have been here before, you've heard my spiel, but I see some new faces, so I want to let you know why we did this here in the library and then introduce our speaker. So this event is hosted weekly by the Seattle Central College Library because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. So while we have lots of opinions, lots of topics that you'll find on our shelves, in our databases, and in this classroom, we hope that you have the opportunity to learn from a wide range of viewpoints, whether or not you agree with everything you hear today. So I'll ask everyone to remain respectful of their peers and our presenter as we have our discussion. If you're interested in learning more about this topic, the history of this topic, or what else you can do, we have some resources at the front that come from our collection. All of these are available to check out. And if you'd like to know more, you can contact any of the reference librarians that you can find at the big desk in the middle of the library, and they'll be happy to help you. At the end of this, I'll ask you to fill out a brief survey, just letting us know what you liked, what you didn't like, how we can improve. And if you're interested in hosting one of these sessions, we love faculty, staff, and students host. If you feel passionate about a topic, please come talk to me. We can get you on the schedule. So next week, Joel Sisolak from Capitol Hill Housing will lead us in a discussion about the Capitol Hill Eco District and advancing neighborhood sustainability. But today, the reason you're all here, please join me in welcoming Ty Pethe, president of WFSE Local 304, as we dialogue about Seattle housing crisis and what happened.
Great, thank you. Thank you for letting me come talk to you guys today. On top of being our current union president, representing our classified staff, I've also been involved in housing in Seattle for quite a few years. First of all, I am proud to be a Seattle resident and also a renter. Currently rent a house on Beacon Hill with six of my friends, and it's an old house that my friends have been renting for the last decade. So I'm sort of one of the lucky few that has found that affordable housing in our community. On top of that, I've also been a volunteer with SAFE, which stands for Seattle Against Foreclosure and Eviction. I also have many good friends who are involved in the Seattle housing scene. Every sort of position, from being apartment managers and dealing with the rental market, to having people involved in the affordable housing market and how best to provide affordable housing, to even a couple friends who own enough land to be investors in the property in Seattle. And so today what I really want to do is give sort of a summary and a background, and then talk about some of our current debates that our city is discussing on housing, and then open it up for a dialogue over some of those issues. So I want to start by saying that housing is a really complex subject that works at multiple levels within our society. First of all, it's deeply personal to every single one of us, because we all need a place to live. And everyone has different wants and desires in where they live, what sort of place they live in, and what they need out of the neighborhood. They also have certain barriers to what they really truly desire based upon income, based upon affordability, based upon those neighborhoods, and what's available. And so it becomes a very personal issue to all of us trying to find a good place to live. On top of that, it's also a key example of capitalism and market rate economics, because we function in a society where most of our land is privately held, bought, sold, and invested in. So it plays a part in that economic market. But on top of that, we have many nonprofits and also governmental organizations that have a vested interest in housing and making sure that people have that human right to housing, as a lot of people would frame it in that way. And also as a city, how do we provide housing or have housing options for everyone that's in that city? And how do we do urban planning? So I think one of the big backgrounds for us in Seattle is that, like most cities, our housing market is really strongly tied to the overall job market and the economy of our city. And we've actually been through a few major booms and busts in the housing cycle. We saw a major one in the 70s when a plant for Boeing did not open up in Seattle. We saw another one in the 90s when Boeing was pulling back. But we've also seen some really huge booms. Back in 2000, we saw the tech bubble rise and housing in Seattle got really expensive. Also, we're currently seeing another boom, where we're seeing a lot of people coming into our area and large positive growth rate of people coming into Seattle. And that's creating a boom cycle. We're seeing a demand for housing, and a lot of the private equity is building that housing, hoping to make a profit off it. So, I think that's the part I really want to start on is back in 2008. And that's the last sort of downturn of our markets, and it's one that really hit the whole nation and the whole country. I think we all know about the Great Recession, and I think we can remember back the big bubble burst. We saw a lot of communities, especially in economically fragile areas like the Rust Belt, California, Florida, have housing markets that were completely underwater. And what that means is that the mortgage that they paid, that they took a loan out to do, is now worth more than the cost of that home. And so, for example, a homeowner in Detroit might have bought a nice family residence, family house, for $250,000. They put the mortgage down, they got that loan, and they invested in that piece of property, thinking it would retain that value. And when we saw that bubble burst, suddenly overnight, those housing prices dropped. And so that house that they bought for $250,000 is now worth $175,000. They still owe more to that mortgage, to that loan, than the actual value of that house. Now, this is a crisis on itself, but in this bubble, a lot of people were given bad loans, where their income was inflated, where the interest rate was too high, and where we saw also an economic downturn because of this, and people lost their jobs. And so in that crisis, it sort of compounds. People are less able to buy a new home, they're less able to keep the home they may have currently, and it hits a lot of pressures. So that brings the cycle of the value of the houses down even further. In Seattle, we were sort of lucky. We still had a positive growth rate in our city. It went down to about 1%, but we still had people that were moving in, so our city was still growing. There was still a demand. At the time, our housing stocks were adequate. We had about a 4% vacancy rate, which means about 4% of the houses, apartments, and condos available are unoccupied and looking to be sold or rented. However, we still had a lot of people that were really struggling to make those mortgages and provide that. We also had the eventual end that people face when they can't provide that loan, which is foreclosure. And that's when the bank decides that you are negligent in your payments and they repossess that home in order to try to recoup that debt. And so there were a lot of really interesting things that happened nationwide at that 2008 bubble burst. We saw a national movement come out of the Occupy movement called the Housing Jubilee. And the Housing Jubilee tried to address this crisis across our nation by collective groups in each local area through a couple different mechanisms. First of all, they tried to get more protections for those people that own those homes. They tried to renegotiate those loans whenever possible to refinance. But also a lot of different housing jubilees decided to build a land trust. And what a land trust means is that a nonprofit will buy that land and hold it as part of a combined trust of land, and then sell or lease that land to residents at an affordable and lower rate. There's also generally a clause that's a buyback clause, where if the homeowner then wants to sell, they have to sell back to that housing trust, so then that house can then be resold to another person that wants to live in that community. Or if they're on a lease, the lease is again stopped, purchased back by that land trust, and then re-leased to someone else that wants to live there. In Seattle, we didn't really have a strong jubilee. What we really had was SAFE, the Seattle Against Foreclosure and Eviction. And SAFE's big goal was to try to hold banks accountable to providing reasonable loans and rates, adjusting the loan rates, and trying to refinance homes so that people could stay in their house, still make those payments, and have a mortgage that was equivalent to what the current value of those homes were. And some of you who are here may remember back to this time, back in 2009, 2010. Our wonderful council member, Kashama Sawant, was active in this movement, and she actually was arrested multiple times, standing in blockades, where people from SAFE stood outside that house to prevent entry into that house by the cops trying to evict the resident. There was multiple times where she spoke out against sort of the predatory lending practices that we had seen in our community. And a lot of what brought her to that eventual position as our city councilman was really working on that and playing part in the community at the time. And that brought her a lot of press and publicity over these issues. At the same time, the city of Seattle was really trying to figure out what they could do to try to help citizens in our city. And so they commissioned a study from a conservative economics scholar named Robert Hockett, who I believe is at Clark. He took a sabbatical, and he did a lot of research into our condition in Seattle and what our housing market looked like. And he found that we had a pretty high vacancy rate. Many of these were in foreclosure. A lot of people could not afford the rates that they were paying, and that something had to be done, or else we would see a major downturn in our market. And going through this and picking out the best analysis and statistics to try to really focus on what the most likely numbers for all that is, he came up with a couple suggestions. First of all, he liked the idea of the city providing money and grants for a land trust to buy those homes that are foreclosed and then sell them back to the original residents if they could afford it. And that would be sort of trying to renegotiate those payments because the land trust would be then buying out those foreclosed homes at the current market value and then selling them back to the residents. He also proposed the idea of default swaps, where one homeowner would partner with another homeowner, and due to the laws, if they are not living in that boat, it can't be repossessed and foreclosed. And so they would go through that bankruptcy point at that time, and then they would move back into their original homes. And it was a legal sort of loophole around foreclosure and eviction laws. And the final idea that he had that I think was most scary to our city was the idea that if none of these can work, and we still see vacancy, and we still see foreclosed homes that are empty, it is better to actually use eminent domain to, as the state, take ownership of that property from the banks or from the institution, take ownership of that, and then put that into a nonprofit, affordable housing, a land trust, or another public option. And eminent domain has a really scary history across our country, and there's some good arguments about it. The idea is that the state, if it is in the best interest of all the citizens, can take land, own land that's owned privately, and take possession of that to be better used. A lot of the original ideas of eminent domain come out of the railroads in the 1920s, where there might be one farm holder that was preventing the last link of a giant continental railway, and so it was in the best interest of our nation, both economically and for, you know, commerce and housing and movement, to repossess that farm, just pay them whatever it was worth, and kick them off the land. This idea of eminent domain has also been used, though, commercially. We saw an example of it where they tried to do that with a house down Ballard, where the developer was developing the entire block, and the one single homeowner did not want to move. And the city thought about using eminent domain to repossess that house, again, force the owner to sell it, give her that money, so it could be used for that commercial development, which the city thought might be an economic benefit to everyone in Ballard. At that time, they got enough pressure and feedback that they decided not to do this, and even to this day, you can still go down to that shopping complex in Ballard and see that house. It's just stuck right there in the middle of the whole complex. So eminent domain is scary because of that backlash. A lot of us really believe firmly in private property rights. And we find the idea that the government can just go in and possess our property a really scary idea. It seems really un-American. It seems against our core values. And it seems like a bad option. And so it's one that is often used as a last resort by, you know, the government, whether it's city, county, state, or federal. But it was suggested. He felt that, you know, this could be one of the few ways of preventing blight. And what blight means is that if you have vacant homes in the area of your city, and they're unused, they often decay, fall into disrepair. Sometimes they're lived in by people that are not able to afford their own home, or traveling, or potentially criminal. But that blight can cause a lot of damage, not only to the community, but also the values of the homes around it, which can further escalate problems. So, of course, none of these options really looked great to the city of Seattle. They didn't like the idea of eminent domain. They thought that was too scary, wouldn't work, and they would probably lose the next election if they did that. They thought the idea of getting citizens to default swap and get around the legal loopholes of a default and owning your property was bending the rules enough and shouldn't be what our civil government should be recommending to the citizens. And they thought the idea of the land trust, that would be a lot of money that the city of Seattle just couldn't imagine how they could provide their budget. So they basically passed on all these ideas. However, even though our market's improved, and even though we have more people moving in, housing values have gone back up, and we haven't seen that blight that we worried about, we are still facing a lot of housing prices currently, as we all know. Over the last 4 years, rents have been escalating every single year. We've seen nearly a 1.5% increase, or 1.5 times increase, 150% increase in the price of rental units. And we've seen a lot of the same price increase in property values overall. And at this point, the idea of housing and buying a house is really unaffordable and not available to many of our residents. Even the idea of renting can sometimes be really difficult for most of us. And I think there's some key statistics that at this point I want to give you guys. First of all, the median income, the household median income, means the combined income of everyone living in a single residence, is currently at $67,100 per year. This is the figure that's often used for determining affordable housing and what the cost of that should be. And so affordable housing, to be able to be applicable, apply for, it's generally 80% of that household median income. Which means if you make $53,680 a year or less, you are probably completely able to apply for some sort of affordable housing in the city of Seattle. Now, added to that, I think that makes us scarier, is our per capita income. And that means the average income of someone in Seattle, King County. And that per capita income for just one person, that average of all our incomes over everyone, is only $39,886. Which means your average Seattle citizen probably qualifies for that affordable housing rate. Now, some affordable housing have to decide who they really can provide that benefit for. Some go below that 80% to 50%. Some measure by the amount of people in that household or the amount of dependents. Oftentimes, when different nonprofit organizations are looking at providing affordable housing, they use a lot of those different metrics to get people that are most in need into those small amount of available affordable housing options. But even with that, we've seen 2 to 3 year waits with many of our nonprofit and affordable housing organizations, which means that if you have kids in a family, and you have a single income for that whole entire family, and you're making that $39,000, even though you obviously qualify, and you're one that they really want to provide that option to, you could end up waiting for 2 or 3 years on a waiting list before you see an apartment or a house that you're able to afford. we're also seeing a loss of some of our affordable housing with the redevelopment that's currently going on. Yesler Terrace, which was one of the few shining examples of the HUD project, which is a national affordable housing and low-income housing development project. It was one of the few key that really worked, that built a community around it that was successful and stable. But we're seeing that currently being redeveloped because it's an attractive part of First Hill, because they are trying to keep that for more market rates, and they're trying to increase density. What density means is that the amount of people that can live in a single block or part of the city becomes higher. That usually means going from single family homes into apartment complexes, condos, or other larger buildings that can fit and accommodate more people in that single land footprint. And so since we're seeing this problem, again, our city wanted to find an option. They wanted to have good governance, and they really wanted to set that social policy. And so they commissioned the HALA report, which stands for the Seattle Affordability and Livability Assessment, I believe. And the HALA Commission reports had a group of investors, landowners, single-family homeowners and residents, nonprofit housing advocates, and different people from the community that have a vested interest in our subject matters, experts in this, to all work together to look over the current data and to provide the city with an actionable plan of what they could do. And from this HALA Commission report, they released a 50 or so page long, report with 36 key points, but they really boil down to a couple key things. First of all, we need more density in our urban villages and urban cores. So neighborhoods that are considered urban villages are ones like Ballard, or Beacon Hill, or the Rainier Valley area. They're self-sustaining neighborhoods that have mass transit options, where we see a mix of residential, but also some commercial and retail businesses. They're small, little urban cores stuck within our city. And so they felt that since you could have higher density in there, because there was transportation, mass transit, to be able to move people around, and there were corridors for roads that went through these areas, and there was already retail and commercial activity, that we could expand and make those areas more dense. They also believe that charging a linkage fee, which is where the city charges you a fee to hook up to all the utilities when you're in that construction, could be used to really help build more affordable housing and provide more funding to those nonprofits doing that affordable housing work. They also decided that the 10% rate for affordable housing was not high enough. And so there was a lot of debate in that report about what should be the required amount of affordable housing that any new construction project is required to build, and what the rates for paying a fee to the city if you don't want to provide that affordable housing in that new building should be. And so a lot of these ideas, especially because they came from a social justice point of view, where they're looking at equity across different gender, race, ethnicity, and other personal identity lines, became really controversial. When it first came out, some of these social justice components were really picked up in the news and, lambasted and argued about and really not liked. It was seen as too much of an activist move in that report. The other thing that got a lot of criticism when it first came out was the fact that a lot of single family homeowners in those neighborhoods did not like the idea of larger, more dense, more urban areas in their neighborhood. They didn't like the idea that Capitol Hill might have 4 or 5 story condo complexes and apartment complex across Capitol Hill, or Ballard, or Fremont, or the U District, or any of those urban villages. To them, building that density would remove that character of the neighborhood and remove that value that they had. It would, might get rid of some green spaces and some parks and some other attractive features that they valued. It might have more people in those schools that they send their kids to. And it would change the culture of those neighborhoods. So this got debated, and you know, there was a bit of equivocation and hesitance from the mayor when this first came out, because he didn't really want the criticism from this report, from the committee he commissioned. And so they put up to a public forum back in September. And given that I'm interested in this topic, and it's one that I'm passionate about, I went to that, you know, hearing and that forum. And a lot of the same things that we've been talking about today came up. A lot of people who were single-family homeowners really spoke to the value of their neighborhood and the value of their community, and how if they allow for single residences to be built on that property, like a mother-in-law cabin, that might change that neighborhood. It might bring people in that they don't see fitting into that neighborhood. A couple were even so blunt as to say it might bring in the undesirable element. Because to them, the value was that Seattle should remain a single family home residency city, and that we as a city should have these opportunities for families and for kids to grow up in a home that the parents own, and that that was a higher value to them. On the other side of this forum, you had a lot of people that were younger, that were moving into the city, that were trying to find available options for housing, that knew they could not afford the down payment and mortgage on a new home. And so they wanted affordable housing. And they wanted density in those neighborhoods that were attractive to live in, those urban villages. They wanted the option to have other residencies on single family homes, so that they might find a mother-in-law cottage that they can rent out that might be more affordable. And they want to see the city grow. They wanted to have the city acknowledge that we have an increasing populace, and that we can't just deny them the right to live in the city. And also, more important, that people are in the city who are making that per capita wage or below. They want to have options, so that they didn't feel like they were forced out of the city and had to go further and further away to find a piece of property that they could rent or own and afford to live in. And this got debated in a very heated discussion, back and forth, over 3 hours, by many different people from different parts of our community that were passionate about these issues, that were passionate about finding a place that they could live, that wanted to see an urban, young, vibrant city with affordable housing and available rent that they could afford, or retaining that community spirit and that single family home and those residency neighborhoods and the value and culture of that. And so this is where I leave you and where I invite the discussion. This is what we're currently dealing with. We're currently dealing with this struggle in our community versus the value of home ownership, the investment in that, the building's sweat equity, the getting the money that you've invested your home out, and being able to have these single family home neighborhoods for families and people that want to make that investment and can make that investment. And it's juxtaposed and in conflict with the urban, younger, more diverse, generally lower income demographic that believes that a home should not be necessarily just about that investment value, and that we need to have more than just single family home neighborhoods, and that we need to have a place where anyone can find affordable rents. And that's the conflict. And the conflict comes from how we change those neighborhoods to build, to either give that supply of housing that people can have affordable housing, or not, and face increasing house and rental prices. So at this point, what do you guys think? If you raise your hand, I'll call on you. Thoughts? Questions? Comments? Concerns? Yes?
Thank you for giving such a brief but thorough history. It is a complex topic, as you said. Are there any other cities in this country or that you know of internationally that have faced a similar situation and how they dealt with it? Anything you can glean?
There's a more than a couple. I mean, San Francisco is an example, Berkeley. And there's been a lot of different actions that people have taken. Everything from becoming more dense and more urban. Some cities have decided to make that growth and build up and build a more dense, affordable area. Different countries internationally have looked at ideas of land trust, of nonprofit housing and affordable housing through that, and more of a governmental solution on that. And there's also certain solutions that the government can do that might change or tweak that metric, such as adjusting property tax, maybe making land value tax. And these are two different ideas. A property tax takes the whole entire assessed value for a home, both the land and also the building or improvement. So if you look at property values, you'll see a land value. For example, my home that I rent on Beacon Hill has about $175,000 in that land value, just for that lot. But then an additional $50,000 of the value for that home sitting on that lot. And so property tax taxes the whole thing, that whole $225,000. A land tax would just tax that lot, that $175,000. And they're different in the mechanism, because while property tax is sometimes more efficient to get everyone to chip in equally, the land value tax can really give people reason to invest in that land, put bigger homes on it, or larger structures, or make improvements, because it's just about that footprint size. And so if you have an empty footprint, like a parking lot, that's just as expensive in tax as a condo complex. And so that land value tax versus that property tax and adjusting that is a way that you'll deal with it. Also, the city of Berkeley and a couple other cities across our nation have thought about the idea of a vacancy tax. And what they discovered is that even with that 5 or 6% vacancy rate, that there was a lot of property being held off the market. There were new building developments, new condos, where the investor in that decided that property tax was so low, they could hang on to that property for years before it really ate in their profit margin. And so they held it off until they can sell it at that peak market value. Also, a lot of our foreclosed homes have this problem because foreclosed homes are not charged property tax. So a lot of our banks can keep these foreclosed homes off the market because they're just an asset. They're just a bit of monetary value that they have on their books that they're not losing any money on. And that still might escalate in price. So an idea of a vacancy tax can fix that. If it's a vacant property or a foreclosed home, suddenly that becomes expensive. It becomes something that makes a loss for you. And so the idea is getting that off your hands as quick as possible and selling it or running it back in the market, which puts more competition, theoretically, and theoretically lowers the price. And so there's a lot of different options that a lot of different cities have played with some success and some failure. And again, it's a complex subject. So, I mean, there's as many different ways to solve this as there are us. I mean, we've seen a lot of the Rust Belt cities have people move in from across the country and just wholesale buy out neighborhoods and blocks and turn them into artist centers and, shared housing and parks and urban farms. Just so that land is used and so that the city has another vibrant part to it again, instead of just having empty homes that are decaying. Again, there's all sorts of ways that they can build taxation and taxational land to change the market, change what the value is. Again, there's working with different nonprofits, like affordable housing providers that just own the space and then rent that out to people, or land trusts that own that land and then lease or sell it to people and then have that sold back. There's many different ways to handle this, and many different creative solutions. Again, you can go back to the eminent domain idea or the credit default swap. Those are other options. Yes?
I just read where the city sold some property near White Center in order to accumulate money in order to provide shelter for homeless people. Why didn't the city instead take that property and build or on it and dedicate it to housing that's affordable, taking care of families and homeless people?
Well, so first of all, they declared a state of emergency in the city of Seattle regarding homelessness just about a week and a half ago. And so they're dedicating brand new funds, I believe $7 million, to provide resources to dealing with the homeless crisis and provide housing to the homeless. That sale of land was, again, to raise that capital, raise that money, to help try to figure out how to solve this housing crisis, this homelessness crisis. I think one of the reasons why the city probably didn't just build on it instead of selling it is that it was a commercial property. It was a training and maintenance bay for King County Metro, if I remember correctly, that the city owned. They would have to either completely redevelop that, tear that down, and then build affordable housing on that, or they could sell it to a commercial provider that would use it for its intended purpose, and they could just use that money, that asset, to then work with affordable housing. But I think the other key thing is that our city is really nervous about getting too involved in housing directly. Instead, they work with a lot of different housing providers and social services agencies. For the homelessness, there's a lot of different shelters that they work with. One of the big ones is a nonprofit called DESC. And so I'm sure that a lot of that money will be going into funding DESC, looking at new sites for new shelters for homeless people, and also looking in the community to what other nonprofits and organizations are already doing that work. And the general reason why they decided to do that instead of doing it on their own is that those community groups and organizations already have a lot of that infrastructure. They've already studied that, they already have a lot of the subject matter expertise. And so the city doesn't want to duplicate those services. But second, if the city did take that direct action to build that housing itself, everyone in our city government and all of our elected officials would be held accountable for how well that worked or not. And so if it had problems or it didn't work beautifully, well, that would be something that your next election would come up and maybe give your challenger a lot more ammunition. So I think it was politically advantageous on top of being sort of efficient for them to give that to other groups doing that work. Other questions? We have a whole 20 minutes, so. Yes.
Thank you. Do you know if any of this construction right across the street will include affordable housing?
I believe that right now the rate is 10% of units in a new building have to be affordable housing. I'm not 100% sure on that figure, but I believe it's 10%. 90% sure that's true. So that developer of that new building down the street will either have to have 10% of their units be affordable housing, according to those figures on the household median income, or they'll have to pay a large fee to the city, so the city can then turn around and give that assessed value of that 10% to other groups doing that affordable housing work. But again, this brings back some of the economic problems that we face. Because if you look at even that per capita rate of $39,886, and we take our best practices on housing, which is about a third of your income should go towards housing, and no more than a third, that means even at that lowest level, that most basic level, that means your monthly rent would still be $1,106.83 per month. And I know that a lot of us would not consider that much to be affordable. It's even worse when you talk about that 80% of household median. It's not only that affordable housing line becomes closer to 1,500. And who here thinks that $1,500 is an affordable rate for rent? I don't think any of us.
No.
So there's still that concern of exactly what affordable housing really even means. And I think that's something that's helpful is thinking back to what the housing prices were. Right now, the average housing price across our city as of July 2014 was about $1,200 a month. 3 years ago, before that, it would have been $800.
That for a one-bedroom apartment?
Yep. So we have to think about that rapid escalation of price. I think some of the concern for all of us is that we've seen that same economic change with well-paid high-tech companies moving in, providing jobs, changing that economic, you know, market of the city, and changing those demands for housing in San Francisco. And so we've seen San Francisco go from an affordable, you know, nice city to being absolutely unaffordable and one of the most expensive ones in the city. I think another thing that we all should be concerned about, and it's probably on our mind, is our own costs of living in our area. We are one of the lowest taxed cities overall across the nation. However, if you're median to low income, we are the highest taxed city in the nation. If you make about $40,000 a year or less, you generally pay about 12% of your income into city, county, and state taxes. Whereas if you're in that upper bracket, you pay about 6%. And so a lot of the burden of our civil governance that we all need, that we rely on, really comes out of our pockets. We are the most progressive states in the nation for taxation. And so we're bearing the burden as citizens to pay for those states for living. It's something that we all want, you know, the Department of Ecology to make sure that we have clean air and clean water. I think we want the DOT to make sure our roads work and function. I think we want to provide for education, make sure there's K-12 schooling, and so there's funding for higher education. I think we want a lot of the services that our government provides, but we still have a big fight in the state about how to pay for that. But that's another burden that plays in that housing in Seattle when you live in such a high cost living area in that way. Yes?
I was curious about options that value both like community living and also density. Is that something that's like being prioritized?
Sort of. And it depends. And it really depends again on that who you are and what neighborhood you have. One of the options that Paula threw out was again opening up other structures on single family home properties. So again, you could own a home and have a backyard, but then you could build a separate structure, a one bedroom mother-in-law cottage or cabin. And that would create density in those single family home neighborhoods and provide affordable living options to people that want to move on that. They also looked at increasing the amount of people that can live in a single home. Right now it's capped at 6. So if you have 7 people living in your home sharing that house, you're technically in violation of, you know, city law. And so they wanted to think about raising that to 8 or 9, potentially. There were thoughts about looking at neighborhoods and looking at places that are already becoming more dense, such as along the arterials. A good example is Broadway here, where you see a lot of large, tall structures, residency structures, being built on Broadway, on the urban strip and the corridor. But we don't see as much of that further away from that. The further you get out of the neighborhood, the more solid and stable single-family homes you have. And a lot of people thought that was a good compromise in some ways. And of course, the younger, more urban, dynamic group of people really wanted that option. But again, a lot of the single-family homeowners who've been there for 20 years didn't think that was a good compromise. They worried about who would be in that mother-in-law cottage or watching that property, or how that would match in the neighborhood. They worried about parking and congestion. Is there enough street side parking for that additional person in that car? They worried about, you know, if you build on those urban cores, how long is it going to be until they don't have a view, until they don't have good property, until they get trees cut down, until their neighborhood isn't the green, pleasant single-family home neighborhood that they all like and want. And so, again, it's that difference in value. And there's some good compromises again. But is there a good option that everyone's going to agree to? Not yet. Questions, comments? So, I tried to pass out to everyone. There is a list of further reading and references. I made sure at the top to start out with that one from 2011. That was the commission report on what we could do to fix the post-bubble, you know, problem. And I ended it with the current Hollow Commission report. If you really want to dig into all 36 of the different suggestions they made and really see the debate on housing and what TEL might look like 10 years from now, read the whole report. It's dense. It has a lot of terminology. It can be a little hard to struggle through. I'll admit all of that. But when you really dig into it, it can be a very interesting document. And it says a lot of really interesting things on trying to build equity across disenfranchised communities and trying to retain marginalized or at-risk communities in our city. And so that social justice piece is really interesting to see in that report, and it comes out anyways. There's also a lot of different links on different ideas, like a vacancy tax, like land tax, like other solutions that could fix this. And so I try to give some sort of a broad list of different potential options. So if you're interested in any of that, it's a pretty good list, it's not expensive.
I have a question about the meeting that you went to. When was it? Last September? Last
September,
right? Okay. So I'm curious about the demographics of the folks who showed up. And so you mentioned that there are some really vocal folks who live in single family neighborhoods, and that there were also some of the younger and, you said, hipper, I guess, people. Well,
more urban.
More urban,
yeah.
Okay. But what does that mean? So what do you feel like there was decent representation from some of the folks who might be feeling that they're getting pushed out of the city? Or was it more the folks who maybe could eventually afford, I don't know, a house in the area? Does that make sense?
It did. I think what was most stunning and most interesting to me about the demographics of that group is that you could not divide either of those groups by personal identity.
Mm-hmm.
You could not distinguish them by race, by gender, by ethnicity. Both were very diverse, very mixed groups. And you had a lot of people that you would think would be good allies, really bitterly fighting each other. You had homeowners that had bought a land trust home, who had bought an affordable home for their neighborhood, saying that everyone should have that opportunity and we should all just have single family homes. Because this is how I'm going to raise my kids. And so again, those people that need those options, that come from a very diverse background, we're arguing for the same thing that's driving up our property values and our rental values. At the same time, you saw some very old, very much your typical Ballard, Seattleite, you know, your quintessential picture of that sort of NIMBY neighbor, again, arguing for that single family home. And on the other hand, you saw the same thing. You saw people that were racially, ethnically, gender, sexual preference-wise, diverse, arguing for that density. There were LGBT groups that really said that we can't live on the hill because the hill's being overdeveloped. And we need more density on Capitol Hill so that our neighborhood and our culture of our neighborhood doesn't change. But all that intersectionality and that diverse group all arguing over what they find the value in their neighborhood being was a really interesting and really sort of shocking conversation.
Yes? What do you think the city should do?
Personally, I'm a huge fan of smart density. If you look at those urban villages, I think that along those denser urban cores of them, we should build, we should keep building. I think on Capitol Hill or along Broadway, sure, let's put up 5 or 6 story affordable housing or condos or apartments. Because it's those buildings that become older that will then become the cheaper, lower rent in 10 years from now. I think that there's areas that have high mass transit where people can move quickly, especially along the light rail, that really would benefit from having more people being able to live in those neighborhoods, work in those neighborhoods, and commute across the city without having to drive a car. I think that that smart density, picking out those areas where you have a high amount of transit and already a developed retail and commercial core, makes sense to build a lot more density. And I think that we should also keep building more mass transit and keep moving the light rail across our city so that we can have more people that can commute by that mass transit and lower traffic and make it a cleaner, more lovely place to live. I also think that we really, at some point, need to look at our taxation. I think overall, we need to look at how to have a progressive tax system statewide. But I think that also we should look into how do we keep all of those homes, all of those condos, all of those apartments in that market. And so I think the idea of a vacancy tax to keep that in the market and keep that market stable is a really good idea. And I think that more to the point, it should be something that's a rather punitive vacancy tax. My best suggestion is to have about a 3-month grace period, because most homeowners that are selling their property will sell it within that 3 months. But after that, have a monthly increase in vacancy tax, where the 4th month it starts out with 2%, 5th month it would be 4, 6 months it would be 6, and so on escalating. Because that would put a really urgent need and market pressure to keep all those homes in the market, being used, being lived in, and it would take away some of that investment value, some of that monetary profit margin out of housing. And I think that if we really make housing an investment and a commodity market, we're going to lose that purpose and that human reason, which is providing someone a place to live. So I think going back to some of that original value is important. I would also say that a lot of our nonprofit housing and our housing advocates really believe that housing should be considered the next human right, and that having a house or having a place to live is a human right. And I think that's also something that we should really take to heart, because everyone needs shelter, everyone needs a place to live. It's been shown that the more you provide housing, it actually brings the cost to that society, to that government, to that city down. Because it's actually more expensive to have people that do not have housing than it is just to provide them a place to live. The cost to our social services, like our hospitals, like our charity situations, like our police force, like our first aid, that cost of having someone that does not have housing is actually more expensive than actually providing that housing. And so I think that housing as a human right is not only economically efficient for us as a society, but it's also a moral value that we should have. Yes?
How much of the homeless crisis do you think is due to the high prices in housing?
Well, I do know it has an effect. There was sort of a heartbreaking moment yesterday at the staff retreat where someone that won one of our door prizes came up and they said who they are and where they work and we asked her what to do. But then she said, I'm really happy. I'm really celebrating right now. I've been homeless for the last 3 months. I've been living out of my car. And just last week, I finally got a place to live like before. And for someone that works full time, that's a really awful and tragic situation. I don't know about you, but if you work full time, I think you should be able to afford a place to live. And I think that that does play back, because there are people that are trying to scrape by because they can't find an affordable place to live. And I think that part of the guilt and part of the shame that people face and feel when they're in that situation really prevents them from talking about it and from us to realize how large an issue that really is. Okay, so we have just about 5 minutes, a lot of people are wrapping up. Any last questions? No? Okay, well, thank you so much for having me.